We have Democratic Congressman Tom Malinowski. Now, he knows firsthand, all right, he was the former Assistant Secretary of State during the Obama administration. He was well aware of what Biden was doing and why. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, sir.
Now, just to hit a couple of points of where we are in the state of play. You heard Fred Flights, smart guy, attacking the whistleblower. One big reason is obviously the enticement of the unknown, but also they don't like the transcript. Mm-hmm. Do you care as much about the whistleblower when you have the text of the call?
No. We're all interested in the human drama of the whistleblower, but we know what the president did. He traded our national security for political favors. And how do we know? Because they admitted it. They released the transcript. So we have, it's a rare congressional investigation that begins with most of the facts in hand. Obviously, we have to take this further. Even if you catch somebody robbing a bank in America red-handed, you still have a trial and a jury and witnesses and testimony. But we basically know the heart of the matter.
You certainly know. You don't know the people that the whistleblower was talking to, the kind of flesh out the different aspects of why this was going on and how.
Sure.
But you do know that it's not made up out of whole cloth because you had the call.
Mm-hmm.
Two defenses. First one, president was just enlisting the help of an ally with matters of corruption. And in fact, William Jefferson Clinton signed a treaty on exactly that with Ukraine. And that's all this is.
He did not mention corruption in this phone call. He's shown no evidence of any interest in corruption in Ukraine. All he wanted was the dirt on his political opponent, Joe Biden.
So now that's the second defense. By the way, I'm right about Joe Biden. Joe Biden held the money over Ukraine's head until they got rid of the prosecutor that was looking at the company that his son was working with. Now, those are all true statements. He was holding up the money. He did want to get rid of the prosecutor. The prosecutor was in charge of a case into the person who owned the company that Hunter Biden sat on the board of.
Not he, we. This is the key. There was a crooked prosecutor in Ukraine who was not bringing prosecutions on anybody. There was absolutely not a single active anti-corruption prosecution going on in Ukraine, including with respect to this company that Biden's son was involved in. We, the United States government, and our allies in Europe and the International Monetary Fund and every international institution that was trying to help Ukraine at the time said, you got to get rid of this crooked prosecutor and get somebody who will actually go after these cases. So the irony is Biden, who is just the messenger, one of many messengers of this policy, was trying to get the Ukrainians to do something that would place, if his son had been doing anything wrong, would have placed his son in greater jeopardy, not less.
By replacing the prosecutor and having somewhat of a say in the new one that came in, why isn't that reasons of suspicion?
Well, we didn't have a say in the new one that came in. What we basically said, all of us, again, not just Joe Biden, was that you got to get somebody who will actually prosecute corruption across the board.
What do you think of the notion that it doesn't look good? Doesn't look good when you're in charge of something and your son is in the purview of what you're taking on?
Yeah, I wouldn't even say he was in charge of something. I mean, John Kerry made this point to the Ukrainians. The president of the United States, Barack Obama, was in charge of this policy.
But they made Biden the point person, we're told.
A point person.
Point people can you have?
We had our ambassador. We had the Secretary of State. We had every single official who was working on Ukraine.
Joe Biden brags that he's the one who held the money over their head, and that's why they did it.
Well, we did, and it was successful. So I can understand why he would say, I was involved in a successful policy. But it was the right policy, because we did condition aid, absolutely, on Ukraine actually doing something about corruption, because we wanted to make sure that our money that we were helping them with loans and loan guarantees wasn't being stolen.
Did you know Hunter Biden's existence and role at that time?
I did not.
Why not?
It was not significant.
Well, it was certainly significant. Should it have been disclosed? Was there anything done that you wish had been done differently?
Well, I think it was disclosed. I don't think it was something that I was personally aware of at the time, because it was just so obviously our administration, our national policy. I was not thinking about this as Joe Biden's policy, because it wasn't, and it was the right policy.
You never heard Joe Biden talking about any concern about his son. You are 100% that Biden didn't do it for his son.
I'm 100% that Biden did it as the messenger of an administration policy that was set by dozens of people. You know, in the Obama administration, in fact, all past administrations, we had something known as a policy process. We met together in rooms and we talked about this stuff and we set strategies and we checked each other's notes, and then we decided, okay, you're going to go out and deliver the message, and you're going to be reinforced by this person and that person. Nobody was freelancing. We did not have a Rudy Giuliani in the Obama administration who was running a shadow foreign policy on behalf of the president or vice president. That's what's going on right now.
So now what's going on right now on your side of the ball and in the government is you have to do an investigation to make a determination, to make a case to the American people that you have a set of accusations that warrant articles of impeachment against the president. Abuse of power is what this is going to fall under as an umbrella. I don't think, you know, you just heard me talking to Baker and McCabe. I, with all due respect, don't see you making a bribery or a treason case. I don't think you have it. Abuse of power. What kind of abuse of power, in your opinion, warrants articles of impeachment?
I've spent my life working on foreign policy and national security. What offends me about this is that the president of the United States is now apparently basing our country's foreign policy on whether foreign leaders will help him politically, whether they will do him personal political favors. Think about what that means. This foreign policy is supposed to be about protecting us, our interests, our values. We have thousands of troops in Europe right now there to deter Russian aggression against Europe, including Ukraine. We were providing anti-tank missiles to stop Russian tanks from invading Ukraine. And to condition that, our national security, our national interest, on whether this sordid deal is done where Ukraine manufactures dirt against his political opponent, if that is allowed, where does that stop? Do we now like give China a better trade deal if they cough up dirt on Biden or Buttigieg or somebody else?
His defense will be, I didn't ask for it to be manufactured. But I hear what your theory of the case is. The point now is to make it compelling, overwhelming to the American people so that it's something they think has to be dealt with now, not in an election that's around the corner.
Well, it is about the election that's around the corner, right? This is not about what Donald Trump may have done in 2016. This is about what it looks like he is doing now to prepare for the next election in 2020. That's what makes it urgent.
And that's what the line still has to be, that we know what you're able to show, and we look forward to the proffer from the people in the House. And you're always welcome to come here, Congressman.
Thank you, sir.
To talk about what matters to the American people.
Thank you.
Good luck going forward.
Thank you.
Important job. All right.